do we move towards a fairer world, one where boys and girls have equal rights and opportunities? A new feminist manifesto by the award-winning Nigerian author Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie says that it starts by teaching our daughters that they matter just as much as boys do. Already a literary sensation since her novel Americana explored what it means to be black in America, she went viral with her TED talk on why we should all be feminists, which Beyoncé famously included in her song Flawless and Dior printed on t-shirts last year. I started by talking to Chimamanda, who divides her time between Nigeria and the United States, about the new global reality brought on by Donald Trump's election. Welcome to the program and thanks for joining us from New York.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So this is a moment where all sectors of societies, including artists and writers and everybody, are sort of reacting and laying down their own markers to the political upheaval that we're seeing in the US and all over the world. You have written a very big article for the New Yorker magazine, basically saying now is the time. What do you mean by that exactly in this context?
Because I grew up in Nigeria, and having grown up there, political uncertainty is not unfamiliar to me. I grew up during the 1980s and we had coups. But the US, I think, hasn't quite had to deal with the kind of political uncertainty that I think happened with the election of President Trump. And my essay was really about how it's now time for people to find new ways to talk about politics, to push back, to stand up for what is true and what is right. It's really not the time to make excuses or to hold on to this idea of optimism. It's time to maybe be a bit more realistic, and also time to accept that difficulty is part of the reality of political life.
And I want to move on to one of your most famous works, Americana, because you do live in the United States now, but you are Nigerian. You come from a black country, and yet you said you never experienced really what it meant to be black until you came to the United States.
I think in some ways it's because everyone in Nigeria is black. And so we didn't really think actively of race as an identity marker. And when I went to the US, I suddenly realized that race was this identity that was thrust on me. But what's interesting, I think, about race is that it's not that I have dark skin, which I actually find quite glorious. It is instead that having this skin comes with assumptions, that there are people who look at people who have skin like mine and make assumptions about their ability, about what they should and shouldn't do. And that's why it's a problem.
Well, listen, you are right. It is glorious. So I second your comment just there. But, you know, you came to the United States as a 19-year-old university student and you see that there are huge race relation problems. Obviously, much has improved, but there are still dramatic race relation problems, and some of them exacerbated by the current campaign. What is your take on the state of the race, so to speak, in the United States right now?
I mean, I think that race is America's original sin, and it's not surprising that it remains a problem. Actually, sometimes I find it surprising that some people find it surprising that it remains a problem. I do think, though, that the political leaders can set the tone that one uses to talk about race. I think that President Obama was wonderful at setting this tone in which racism did not disappear, but it wasn't overt. I think what's happened with this administration is that they've set a tone in which casual racism has become okay, in a way, because you have the leader of a country who himself sort of engages in a kind of casual racism. I think that's the same for misogyny as well. And so that the political leadership can set the tone. And I'm not very encouraged about the tone that's been set in this country.
Well, that's for race. What about for feminism and the respect of women? You have, even before this election, in fact, way before this election, you gave a very famous TED talk about feminism. I want to play some of it and then talk to you about what you said and what your manifesto is today.
We teach girls to shrink themselves, to make themselves smaller. We say to girls, you can have ambition, but not too much. You should aim to be successful, but not too successful. Otherwise, you will threaten the man. If you are the breadwinner in your relationship with a man, you have to pretend that you're not.
especially in public. Otherwise, you will emasculate him. But what if we question the premise itself? Why should a woman's success be a threat to a man?
I mean, there's so much to unpick there, Chimamanda. Were you angry? Are you trying to persuade people? Are you trying to knock people over the heads? What do you think needs to be done to resolve this situation, which is still a situation when it comes to gender equality?
All of those things. I am angry. And I think everyone should be angry about the state of gender. But I also want to persuade. I want to talk. I want to have conversations. I think that there's gender imbalance everywhere in the world. A lot of it is infuriating to me because it's about injustice. It is so unjust that so many people who make up half the world's population don't have the access and opportunities that they deserve. But at the same time, I don't think that it means that all men are evil or terrible. I think that privilege means often that one is blinded. I dream of a world where we no longer need feminism because it will be redundant.
And you have actually taken another step and you've written a sort of a new feminist manifesto. You've called it Dear Ijewele, or a feminist manifesto in 15 suggestions.
I wrote it because it started actually as a letter to a friend of mine who had just had a baby, and she asked me to tell her how to raise her baby girl a feminist. And so I started to write down the things that I think we can do differently in raising girls. I think a lot of those also apply to raising boys, but not all of them. It's very important that we live in a world that gives women room to be full people, rather than having them be defined solely on very narrow domestic terms. And also the idea of rejecting likability. I think that young girls everywhere in the world are raised to make themselves likable, by which I mean that I think it's wonderful to be polite and to be civil. Everybody should be. But I think girls are raised with a particularly insidious idea that they have to, you know, they have to cater to the egos of men. Sometimes you have to pretend not to be as intelligent as you are. You can't be too forward.
I want to know your take on Hillary Clinton, who, you know, is one of the most professional women in all of American politics, the most experienced, and yet there was this likability thing that kept getting thrown at her.
I remember thinking when I would read all this coverage about her, why we had to keep hearing about whether or not she was likable. Why was it even a subject? Why didn't we hear that about her male opponent? I think women who seek power or women who have power make people uncomfortable. And so we find ways to judge them in ways that we wouldn't judge men who are seeking power or men who have power.
On that note, Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, thank you so much indeed for joining me tonight.
Thank you very much. It's been lovely.